Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have received apologies from Michael Mara and Daniel Johnson as attending as a substitute. We've also received apologies from Michelle Thompson and Audrey Nicol as attending as her substitute. So I'd like to welcome you both to the committee, and as it's Audrey's first time attending, I invite you to declare any interest relevant to the committee.
Thanks, convener. Nothing to declare.
Thank you very much. So we have one public item on the agenda today, which is an evidence session with the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance on the Scottish Fiscal Framework, Independent Report and Review, and on VAT assignment in Scotland. Ms Robeson is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Matthew Elsby, Deputy Director of Fiscal Policy and Constitution, and Al Caldwell, Corporate Treasurer, Scottish Government. I welcome you all to the meeting and invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, everyone. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to attend committee and discuss the recent fiscal framework review. The agreement with the UK Government to publish an updated version of the Scottish Fiscal Framework on the 2nd of August fulfilled a key commitment in the First Minister's policy prospectus. Since it being agreed in early 2016, the fiscal framework has been thoroughly stress-tested as Brexit, the pandemic, and now the cost of living crisis have unfolded. So it was right to review arrangements and consider improvements. This new agreement with the UK Government includes a balanced set of changes which strengthen the financial management tools available to the Scottish Government and provide the Scottish Parliament and Government with greater long-term funding certainty. That said, I want to be clear that the review was not as broad in scope as the Scottish Government would have liked. This reflects that the scope and process for the review and its outcome were subject to agreement with the UK Government. Nonetheless, under the circumstances, this revised agreement represents meaningful progress and a good outcome for Scotland. The adoption of the index per capita block grant adjustment methodology on a permanent basis is a significant win for Scotland. The independent report authors estimated that use of the indexed per capita methodology for calculating income tax block grant adjustments alone could be worth around £500 million a year by 2026-27 when compared with other methodologies that were considered in 2016. The agreement also provides a substantial increase in the Scottish Government's resource borrowing powers to manage tax and social security forecast errors, doubling from £300 million to up to £600 million per year of borrowing capacity, greatly improving the Scottish Government's ability to manage and smooth funding volatility driven by forecast error. Similarly, the removal of drawdown limits on the Scottish Reserve is also an important development, providing a significant increase in reserve flexibility and improves the Scottish Government's ability to manage funding across financial years. The agreement to uprate borrowing and reserve limits in line with inflation ensures that the effectiveness of these powers will be maintained in real terms, making Scotland's financial management arrangements more sustainable. So taken together and within the context of the narrowly scoped review that was on offer, these are meaningful improvements to the framework and the financial management tools available to the Scottish Government. That said, we should not lose sight of the scale of the fiscal challenge in the aftermath of the pandemic, the ongoing cost of living crisis, and the urgent need to tackle climate change. While the changes to the framework are welcome, they are not of the magnitude required to offset this broader fiscal challenge. This requires action by the UK Government, and I hope that the Chancellor will heed calls from the Scottish Government to take action on public services, fuel poverty, net zero and the cost of living as part of tomorrow's autumn statement. I also want to be clear that I understand the concerns expressed by the committee about the process surrounding the review and its timing. The Scottish Government's preference had been for a process involving broad stakeholder involvement. However, when a window of opportunity emerged earlier this year to conclude an agreement with the UK Government on changes to the framework, I was mindful of the value of securing borrowing powers ahead of the 24-25 budget and that we are dealing with a UK Government as likely to go into election mode soon. So within that context, I judged that it was appropriate and prudent to conclude a deal when it became possible to do so. I hope the committee will recognise the improvements secured through this revised agreement, and I look forward to discussing the detailed arrangements. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that very helpful opening statement. Yes, I think the committee was quite taken by surprise by the announcement. I recall in the 11-16 Parliament, when the fiscal framework was still being constructed, what a tortuous process it actually was. And I have to say that if it hadn't been for the First Minister and Deputy First Minister of the day digging their heels in at the very last minute, we could have ended up with a framework. Indeed, we would have ended up with one that would have cost this Parliament several billion pounds over years, and a deal was struck. So I think we expected this to be a kind of much more drawn-out process, and you've obviously touched on the process there to some extent. So when one looks at the delegation of powers, for example, over taxation, we still see the UK government has control over national insurance, VAT, quite a lot of income tax. It's got corporation tax, excise duties on cigarettes and tobacco, alcohol, fuel duty, savings and dividends, etc., etc. So I'm just wondering whether or not any of these were proposed by the Scottish Government. Now, obviously, we'll talk about VAT assignment in a minute, but I'm just wondering how far the Scottish Government tried to push the envelope. I appreciate you said you had an opportunity, but and it's not a negotiation of equals, clearly, but I'm just wondering where you're pushing in addition to the areas that you've mentioned in your opening statement.
Yeah, so so you're right that there was a window of opportunity that was open to us, and it's fair to say that the former Chief Secretary to the Treasury, John Glenn, was keen to conclude matters in advance of any potential changes to personnel in Treasury, and I think we understood really that this was a window of opportunity that may not remain open for very long. So the narrow scope of the review was made very clear to us. So of course, over time, we have demanded and requested and will continue to do so additional financial levers, the devolution of further taxes, but it was made pretty clear that the scope for a deal, an arrangement, was on the very limited scope that was set out, which I've covered in my opening remarks. And there was a judgment to be made of, do you then just accept the narrow scope in order to get some tangible gains, or do you continue to argue for a widening of the scope? My judgment was that it was what was on the table was limited. There was nothing else going to be put on the table, and therefore it was prudent to secure the gains in a negotiation on that narrow scope that we have eventually managed to do. So these are judgments, and it was my judgment that despite the narrow scope, there were still substantial gains to be made.
Being very diplomatic, actually, in terms of the responses you're giving, I think it seems to me that, correct me if I'm wrong, that you were presented with more or less a take-it-or-leave-it situation with very little wriggle room, and you had, as my mother would say, half a loaf's better than no bread. Is that the kind of a approach that you were effectively presented with?
Yeah, I mean, we had to be pragmatic. I wouldn't want to underestimate the gain made around the adoption of the index per capita block grant adjustment methodology on a permanent basis. And I've set out in my opening statement that could be worth around £500 million a year by 2026-27. I mean, that was something that clearly was important. Also, I was very mindful of the potential negative tax reconciliation quantum for 24-25. Now, we're in a different space in terms of the quantum, but at the start of that process, we didn't know what the quantum was going to be, and that would have had a material impact on our budget next year, and therefore being able to get that increase from £300 million to £600 million it was very important. And of course, now that will be able to cover all of the negative tax reconciliation for next year. So these things were uppermost in my mind while accepting, would we, if we were starting with a fresh negotiation, clearly other matters, some of which you've mentioned, would have been on the table. But in order to secure some immediate benefit, that was my judgment. And so that is what we concluded. And it was very much a negotiation that was with a limited window of opportunity.
Yes, I mean, index per capita was really crucial in terms of securing the deal way back in 2016. I think it's really, because it came in at the very last minute, I think it's really important that it has been consolidated. So I think that's a significant gain. In terms of inflation linking the capital borrowing, that's also clearly important. But one of the things that concerned me when I looked actually at the projected increase in capital available that would result over the next 4 years was that it seems to be tied to the GDP deflator, which of course bears absolutely no resemblance whatsoever to inflation in the capital sector. So even if these limits go up by the amounts that are actually predicated, it will still mean a real terms reduction in capital available to the Scottish Government, will it not?
Clearly the capital outlook is really challenging. You're right to point to that, and that is for a number of reasons that essentially the capital budget has not been inflation proofed, and then that impacts on our capital availability with an almost 7% reduction over the foreseeable future. That has a huge impact on infrastructure investment. But again, there was no option in terms of other mechanisms to be used. That wasn't on the table. And again, it comes back to what was on the table and the limitations in terms of it, of having at least a recognition of the of capital budget growth. That limited gain was something that we felt was important, but changing the mechanism was not on the table. Matthew, I don't know if you want to add anything.
Yeah, I think that's very much where we were. So this was against a world where there was no inflation proofing in the capital budget, so any indexation is better than nothing. The choice over which mechanism to use, well, the GDP deflator is what's used to index most of the public sector costs, and it's for the way the Treasury will view any costs across the public sector. There wasn't really any conversation about using a different method of indexation, but I don't think the Treasury would have countenanced using anything other than the GDP deflator anyway.
Yeah, because prudential borrowing is obviously something we've spoken about over the years. I mean, it's available to local authorities, and it's always seemed bizarre to me and indeed many others that local authorities actually appear to have more flexibility in terms of borrowing than this Parliament does.
That point has been made on a number of occasions. I think there is scope and need for some discussion of these fundamental issues. Would we have liked to have got into that space? Yes. But as I said at the start, when you're in a negotiation, you can only negotiate the parameters of the other party's willingness, and it was narrow. So a judgment had to be made, but these issues very much remain on the table. Acceptable that, as you've pointed out, compared to local authorities, the issue of prudential borrowing is markedly different over the powers of local authorities compared to the Scottish Government and compared to other devolved administrations across the world as well. So these matters remain very live, and we would want to get them into the space of a further negotiation. But as I say, this one was very limited in scope.
Okay, I'm just going to ask a couple more questions, and I'm going to open out to colleagues around the table. First one is just, we've got a summary of changes to the fiscal framework, and they're all pretty straightforward, and I think we've got the committee's got a good grasp on more of them. Colleagues will ask, no doubt, for further clarification. But just on the Coastal Communities Fund, that's the one that I'm a wee bit vague about. You know, it says here the previous situation was that a baseline addition was made equal to the UK government spending on CCF in the year immediately prior to devolution, and it's now going to be absorbed into Barnet with no immediate impact on funding, and the word there is obviously immediate. So I'm just wondering what that will really mean as we move forward, particularly someone who actually represents a coastal and island constituency.
Shall I? The Coastal Communities Fund is essentially an England-only fund where the Treasury adjusted our block grant in response to the England-only spending. So we received roughly £5 million per year in respect of the Coastal Communities Fund through the 2010 to 2018 period. That was a flat adjustment to the block grant, so that wasn't quite the same thing as Barnett. That is just a flat, straightforward increase to our block grant. The Coastal Communities Fund has been disestablished in England, but that adjustment to our block grant remains. So there's no sort of impact on our overall funding. What the fiscal framework is basically trying to do here is just tidy this up and be clear that that adjustment to the block grant remains in perpetuity. If England was to do something similar to the Coastal Communities Fund in future, that would incur a Barnett consequential, and we would get funding alongside that at the same time. So all this is really about is just tidying up a bit of a confusion within the fiscal framework, but it has no impact on our funding position right now. And if there was to be additional funding in line with something like the Coastal Communities Fund, we would get a Barnett consequential in response.
OK, that's great. Thanks very much. So the only question I'm going to ask now is about VAT. And you'll be aware that last week we took evidence on VAT assignment. In fact, we had a round table with a number of organisations, Scottish Fiscal Commission, for example, Audit Scotland, and we only took 50 minutes from a 75-minute session. And the reason we took 50 minutes is because it became very clear that no one seemed to think this was in any way a good idea. Now, we feel it was, perhaps, I might not be speaking for everyone, I'm pretty sure I am, though, that it was added into the Smith Commission so that it could appear that Smith Commission was going to move towards 50% of taxation being devolved at some point, and that was thrown in as part of that mix. But when we actually looked at the intricacies and the nightmare that would be assignation, for example, HMRC gives a briefing on volatility, as indeed did many others. It appeared to us, Fraser Valentine Institute also, for example, SFC, that this is frankly not in Scotland's interest to secure an assignment of VAT. The volatility would be huge. The benefits would be zero that we could see, because you won't have control over the policy. You won't have control over VAT levels at all. It was, of course, a way of getting around the fact that when we were in the European Union, you couldn't devolve VAT to sub-state legislatures as well. So I'm just wondering whether or not the Scottish Government is, A, going to, frankly, abandon the policy of looking at assigning VAT, and B, whether it will still look to consider whether VAT can potentially be devolved in future, but I just want to know what the Scottish Government's position is now with regard to that, because it seems to us that a lot of work has been gone into that over a number of years from Scottish Government officials. I feel for the people who have been doing that work, but it's a dead end as far as we can see it, and that's the unanimous view of the committee and indeed the people who attended the round table and participated last week.
So let me agree that I'm very clear that the uncertainty associated with the proposed approach to VAT assignment, along with the point you've made about the no additional fiscal or policy powers being granted to manage it, is an inherent and currently unmanageable risk to the Scottish budget. So I think a lot of the work that's gone on has tested some of that. And where we got in the fiscal framework review was an acknowledgement of the complexity and the risk. And the concerns really then need to be addressed by both governments. So the process thereafter, following the review, is that officials have met following the conclusion of the review to really establish where both governments stand on the matter and discuss next steps. There'll be another meeting early in the new year where, frankly, evidence from this committee, I think, will be part of the discussion around, are the conclusions about VAT assignment now in a place that is so clear of the recommendations by all of the experts and the evidence heard at this committee. So the outcome of those discussions will be considered at a future meeting of the Joint Exchequer Committee, and what my intention would be to keep the committee updated around that outcome. It is a process that would really need to come to a position that's acceptable to both governments in terms of what happens next, rather than only one government giving its view. So I'm very aware of that, and I would like to try to get to a position that's an agreed position of what we do with the issue. But what I would not countenance in total agreement with you is to take on that inherent risk without any of the policy levers. I just don't think that was maybe fully understood at the time, perhaps to be charitable, that the inherent risk it was going to be totally borne by the Scottish Government and the impact on the budget. So I think what I'd like to think that in the light of all that evidence now, that a conclusion has come to that is pragmatic and sensible.
Institutions I mentioned, the Chartered Institute of Taxation was also participated in, but the HMRC in briefing before us the session told us that the volatility in the current financial year is of the order of 9.81%. I mean, it's just totally, it would be a real shock, I think. We could be, who knows where we could be. So that's the highest it's been in the last 12 years. There's also the bureaucratic cost, etc., and the politics as well of who would gain and who would lose, etc. And I just think, well, this committee is clearly the view that it's actually just not worth the candle for all the stress and distress it would cost. We can't see any real gain for Scotland in it, or indeed the UK. I don't think it would just be a bit of a nightmare.
I think that conclusion is really helpful.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. I'm now going to open up to colleagues, and the first to ask questions will be listed before by Ross.
Morning. Can I pick up the theme of the principles of the Smith Commission, which are obviously inherent within the fiscal framework, both in 2016 and now? And Cabinet Secretary will know that the witnesses who have come to this committee, plus obviously the three Davids, Iser, Bell and Phillips, are very clear that there are tensions within these principles, specifically the tension between taxpayer fairness and the principle of no detriment. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether the Scottish Government accepts that there is that very strong tension, and secondly, out of these two, taxpayer fairness and no detriment, that you would focus on one of them as the particular priority?
So you're right to point out the tensions that are inherent, and I think both are hugely important, clearly. Given the narrowness of the scope of the review and what we were focusing on in terms of the methodology on the ability to borrow, to deal with tax reconciliation and the Scottish Reserve, it's fair to say that was very much in the no detriment territory of making sure that our position was protected as far as we could within that limited scope of the review. Because I was very aware that the decisions around the methodology, for example, would make a huge difference to, as I laid out in my opening remarks, of the quantum within the Scottish budget, taking into account the issues of population growth. So the no detriment issue, I think, played in to a larger extent because of the issues and the narrowness of the scope of the review. I think it would be fair to say, and I guess that's my honest assessment on that. That might not have been the case had it been a broader range of matters that we were looking at in terms of review, but on those particular issues, that was what was foremost in my mind.
It's just been flagged up a lot, and obviously there are debates to be had about whether the Smith Commission principles need to be slightly revised as we go into further fiscal frameworks, because I don't think anybody has said that all the Smith principles can actually be achieved at the same time. I don't think anybody has said that to us. And therefore, it is this balance which Cabinet Secretary has set out this morning of deciding what your priorities have to be in that choice. So I'm just wondering, as we go into a possible five-year period when we have to look at the fiscal framework again, and whereas I understand that both governments would have the facility to make suggestions, whether the Scottish Government would make suggestions about trying to revise the Smith Commission principles.
I think that's a fair comment and a fair assessment. I think that's something we would have to consider. I think the principles were a negotiation, really, weren't they? So a compromise, and that is what emerged at the end of that negotiation and set of compromises from a political negotiation. I think going forward, we've probably learned from that. I think one of the areas, I think, if you look at what we've just been talking about in terms of VAT assignment, is the necessity to be really clear and careful around what is part of that negotiation. Some of these areas were quite last minute in terms of being inserted into the Smith Commission. So so I think the principles would be... I think we would need to be looked at. We would be in a completely different era with a completely different set of arrangements. I think you'd have to look at that in the round. I think you make a fair point.
Yeah, I think a case to be made, and this has been put to us by some witnesses as well, that you know these were different economic circumstances when they were first set up. But also there is an ongoing... relationship between the UK and Scottish Government, which maybe determines that over the next period things could perhaps be looked at again. And just on that point, Cabinet Secretary, you were very complimentary about the Scottish Government's relationship with the UK Government. I think it was on the 27th of September in the Chamber where you spoke warmly about the improved relations between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. I think you actually cited John Glenn. Is it the case that you feel that these negotiations are in a better place than they were before?
So, let me be candid. I think John Glenn was maybe a bit of an oasis in a desert of being able to do business with someone who was very clear about his objectives and was quite... open and straight about it, and I have to say the officials and the Treasury officials were in a very productive space, and that comes back to the window of opportunity. I think John Glenn recognised that that window may only be open potentially as long as he was in the position, if I can be as blunt as that. Look, sometimes it is about relationships. And you can find a negotiation that works both ways, obviously. But when you find a situation where you know there's clearly a willingness on both parts, despite the limitations, just to get business done, then that was where we found ourselves in that situation. Now, obviously, Glenn has now moved on. I've not met with the new CST yet. Hoping to do that and hoping to have a call with her in advance of the autumn statement. But, you know, I think in the midst of the rest of the very difficult relationship we have with the UK government, it was, in my experience of having dealt with a number of ministers, a bit of a breath of fresh air. And I hope I'm not making him blush by saying that. Probably won't do his career prospects much good.
Not at all. I think... it was good to hear that, if you don't mind me saying, Cabinet Secretary, because that has not always been the case. And I think, particularly when it comes to financial discussions and especially the fiscal framework, I think it's very important. And I think the public think it's very important that governments work together to get the best deal for Scotland. So from my perspective, can I just put it on the record? I thought that was very encouraging.
Thank you. Ross, before by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to just return to the Convener's line of question around the changes to capital borrowing limits. And given the point that's been made around the extent to which capital inflation has gone far beyond not just the GDP deflator, but measures of consumer inflation as well. And apologies if you covered this in your answer to the Convener and I missed it, but was there any discussion of even backdating a year or two to apply even the GDP deflator, never mind what capital inflation is actually at?
So, I mean, as you can imagine, we pushed on a number of fronts to try and get the maximum benefit and deal, and you know we were more successful in some than in others. Getting indexation, I think, was better than nothing on capital, but clearly we would have wanted that to have gone further. Capital is the biggest challenge we are facing going forward. And part of the budget, I'll lay out the full implications of that for Scottish budget and for infrastructure projects. But it is a real challenge, and of course links directly to the economy and economic growth around being able to invest in Scotland's infrastructure. So it is crucially important and will be a major impediment to growth. But in the context of what we were able to achieve, we got as much as we were going to be able to achieve in that space. And, we were just not able to expand the basket of measures that were being looked at.
What was the rationale presented to you by the UK government for that, specifically in relation to capital borrowing limits? Without breaking confidences, obviously, it's useful for the committee to understand the extent to which there were competing objectives in terms of public policy, balance of where power lies, etc., versus the politics, the partisan politics of this.
So I think the balance is an important word there, and I think in a negotiation there's always a balance of who gets what out of a negotiation, and what came out the other end we had to get enough to satisfy some of the fundamental red lines we had, and we had a number, but clearly so did the UK government in terms of how far it was prepared to go and not be seen to go too far, because obviously there are those perhaps in the UK government that maybe didn't like some of the outcomes of the fiscal review itself, and therefore everything is a negotiation. But they have red line. They had red lines too, and that I think was one of them that they weren't going to budge on. So I think we got a clear sense, and you know the officials with Treasury officials pushed boundaries on these with each other before John Glenn and I would get in the room to look at where those boundaries actually were in terms of what was acceptable. So I guess balance of what came out had to be a balance, otherwise it wouldn't have been agreed. And unfortunately, that meant compromise on our part as well, and that was one of those elements.
Thanks. And now that...
Can I add 2 points to that? So, first, the Treasury and the Chief Secretary throughout this, they set out their key constraint as their fiscal rules, and that basically any borrowing, any additional fiscal powers on our side would score against their fiscal aggregates, and the Chief Secretary throughout was very clear that this would affect the UK's fiscal position. So that's what sort of confined negotiation, and that's where, although we pushed in places to have greater powers, ultimately they see this as a zero-sum thing, because anything they give us is a loss to their fiscal position. The other thing to mention just on capital borrowing is throughout all of this we had in mind that any additional capital borrowing powers effectively still scores against our resource position. If we borrow more through capital, it is a resource cost in later years. So there's always a consideration of sort of, if we were to increase our capital borrowing powers, what would that mean in practice for our resource position? And that's why sort of indexation and a steady increase over time was a bit of a prize here, because at least because that was a sustainable position to end up on.
Yeah, it's more manageable.
that's really useful to know, because I think it's helpful for us to understand that from the UK government's perspective, this wasn't, it wasn't just about the well-trodden constitutional ground of where power lies, it's also about the current UK government's policies in relation to debt and deficit and contribution to that. Given the point that you've just made, though, Matthew, about the impact of capital borrowing on the resource budget, neither of those budgets are particularly positive for the Scottish Government over the next couple of years. What is the practical effect of this gradual increase in the capital borrowing limit in terms of what Parliament should expect to see? Because the expectations are capital budget's not going to be a particularly rosy picture. Does this fundamentally alter anything? Because it's already been discussed, you know, it's nowhere near where capital inflation's at anyway. We're already at the point where we can't do everything that we thought we would have been able to do a couple of years ago. So what should Parliament expect the effect of this to be on budgets over the remainder of this parliamentary term at least?
I think probably at the margins would be a fair assessment. It helps, but it's not going to make a major impact on our ability in terms of the capital picture.
In terms of strategic priorities for capital spend directly from the block grant versus what goes on borrowing, is there any shift in Scottish Government priorities there, i.e. what would the government consider in terms of capital projects as appropriate for borrowing as opposed to just coming straight from the direct capital grant? Is that position essentially unchanged as a result of this as well?
It's largely unchanged. I don't know, Niall, if you want to come in on that.
Yeah, there's no specific projects are earmarked as this is funded by borrowing and this is funded by the block grant. So just borrowing still represents about less than 10% of the capital budget in totality, so just for practical reality, it can't be assigned to specific projects.
I mean, well, as I said earlier, part of the budget process will require me to come forward to set out what we are able to do in terms of the remainder of this Parliament, but also in terms of the infrastructure investment plan, going beyond, you know, what is the longer term horizon. And you know, we've been also, as you've been looking at innovative financing models to try and do something to fill some of that space, but that's not without its challenges either in terms of resource costs. So there are no easy answers. My plea again would be tomorrow there is an opportunity, the autumn statement, that that there is a change of direction on capital. I think that would be very welcome and something we would that was in my letter to the Chancellor, that there needed to be more support for the capital position.
Thank you. That's me, Convener. Thanks.
Apologies, a wee aside to one of the clerks there just about the letter. Actually, I've received the letter, but the clerks haven't. Dan, it's before by John.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. And I'd just like to follow on really just from that line of questioning. Matthew Elsby stated that essentially that the Treasury's ingoing position was that it was looking at this within the context of its own borrowing. That being said, it doesn't state its borrowing parameters on the basis of an index of inflation. It's as a percentage of GDP on a rolling five-year average, and it states its overall total borrowing against GDP. And indeed, that's how all economies will actually look in broad terms at both their year-to-year quantum of borrowing and indeed their overall debt. So I'm just wondering if that was explored. And likewise, more broadly, is there not a risk? I mean, and actually, to both governments in a sense, because if the principle of taxpayer fairness is as fundamentally ensuring that policies pursue or are cognizant of how they impact tax receipts, that if the Scottish government, if the Scottish economy underperforms or overperforms the UK economy, we could either be left with a more generous borrowing allowance than was intended if we underperform. But if we overperform in 5 years' time, even a 0.5% annual overperformance compared to the UK could leave that quantum looking considerably smaller than it did at the point that it was agreed. So I'm just wondering if that was explored, actually looking at this from within the parameters of the Treasury's own fiscal rules. And secondly, that risk to both governments, if you just index against inflation rather than the economy.
Matthew, do you want to come in on that? I mean, I think it's fair to say that there is risk inherent in every decision. Our starting point was to minimise that risk for the Scottish Government, and I think what came out of the review does that. But Matthew, on that specific point.
Yeah, I think in this it's important to sort of distinguish between the resource and the capital borrowing policy and how that differs and how that is set up and what it's meant to do. On the resource side, and the tax reconciliations is extremely narrow. We can only borrow to cover for forecast error, and that is something the Treasury have been pretty adamant on since day one. We did explore with Treasury whether we could have more generous borrowing requirements there, particularly on things like the tenor length of our borrowing and that sort of thing. But in those places, the Treasury said no. But that is a different kettle of fish to what we look at on the capital side, where we have a bit more flexibility about how much we borrow, what we borrow for, the length of those repayments and that sort of thing. So on the resource side, we absolutely bear the risk that if the Scottish economy grows less quickly than the rest of the UK's, that will be reflected in our tax receipts. Our borrowing isn't there to address that risk. Our borrowing on the resource side is to address the risk around forecast error and reconciliations and the fact that things will move around at different points during the year. Whereas on the capital side, there's an understanding that sort of there may be a need to invest in significant projects at certain times, but it's borrowing we will have to repay back, but we have some flexibility over how we do that.
But both of those things, I mean, even if you're looking at forecast error, that will ultimately actually be driven by the size of tax receipts, not by inflation. But both those borrowing pots, for want of a better description, are indexed against, well, not even inflation, but the GDP deflator. I just wonder, I mean, it just strikes me that even on the Treasury's own logic, they're not indexing against the right thing.
I think there's a reasonable point that getting any indexation is better than nothing. But you could argue that indexing against tax receipts might be better. Indexing against block grant adjustments might be better. Ultimately, there's going to be risks inherent in any indexation, and it's down to sort of where that balance of risk sits.
On a related point, and this is a bit of a pet hobby horse of mine from my previous tenure on the committee. I've always had this fear that the way the block grant adjustments are calculated is becomes risky as time goes on. I mean, fundamentally, you're indexing back to 2016. And when you're in sort of fiscal year, 2017, that's fine. But, the moment you're into fiscal year 21, but let alone 31, that becomes an increasingly synthetic exercise. Was that even explored as something that will need to be reviewed and revisited in future years? I mean, especially I think when you hit the 10-year mark, I think trying to essentially unwind all the different fiscal decisions made by both UK and Scottish governments to try and benchmark and then calculate block grant adjustments becomes so prone to human error, or it certainly becomes a very synthetic exercise. Was that something that was explored in the discussions, even if it's for future negotiation?
So I bring Matthew in. I think you make a really important point, and I guess it comes back to the next phase of negotiation really needs to look at these issues. The point was made earlier on around when the establishment of those principles and agreements was in a very different economic climate, and the economic shocks that we've seen since then, I think, expose some of these matters that really, in the longer term, the next phase of negotiation, I think we need to really look at these in more detail and expose them to the kind of true light of what we know over that longer period of time, rather than the earlier years of devolution, which were economically reasonably stable. Matthew, I don't know.
I think this is one of the places where the independent report helped framed our considerations in this as well, and you'll see in sort of the Scottish Government's evidence to the independent report, we were getting into the space of, are there fiscal insurance mechanisms that we should think about, and to the extent to which sort of block grant adjustments are sustainable in the long run, and the extent to which sort of you can disentangle policy effects from the from block grant adjustments. I think in one particular place, the independent report was helpful in sort of shutting down some of those lines of inquiry, where we were looking at, are there options to rebase? Are there options to sort of reset our block grant adjustments over after, say, 10, 15, 20 years? And I think the independent report and the contributions of the authors was quite helpful in basic shaping that in a sort of... It is very difficult to do that mechanically, and it's very difficult to come up with ways to look at that. Now, I don't want to pretend that sort of that where we got to in 2016 was perfect, and that there's obviously challenges with that. And I don't know if in 2070 we will have this sort of mechanism in place. But I think sort of the contribution of the authors was helpful in sort of saying what are the things that would be quite difficult to do in a way that was fair to both sides, and which wouldn't breach the Smith Commission principles.
Thank you for that. Just finally, and I think this is perhaps something for the committee to explore, and I'm very mindful I'm just a substitute member. It's certainly sort of been questioned by some, just the timing of both the release of the independent report and the final negotiations. And I understand, Deputy First Minister, your explanation that it is very technical. I concede that there is probably a limited audience of interest, but I think nonetheless what we are talking about is the fiscal envelope available to the Scottish Government, which is of fundamental importance to everything that we do. I just wonder if there's maybe been some thought in the Scottish Government that perhaps we should have a period allow for scrutiny and discussion, because these are complicated matters, and perhaps actually, you know, I think we've had quite an interesting and constructive discussion so far this morning, that can actually help analysis. I mean, so going forward, will the Scottish Government undertake to have the possibility of scrutiny? At the very least, I think independent reports, enable them to be digested, because I think having them concurrently, I think, does undermine that ability to scrutinise.
Well, I think all we definitely would want to reflect on the process. I guess what I would say is that so my predecessors, I had engagement with the committee and stakeholders around the early days of the review. And then the independent report was obviously jointly commissioned, which I think was important for its credibility and acceptance as part of the process. And then we had the rapid opportunity to conclude matters where, you know, the CST made it very clear he wanted that to happen in a confidential space. So I wouldn't have had any issues at all with having further engagement with the committee or stakeholders, but given the CST's very clear position, that would have been very difficult. And, you know, sometimes in a confidential space you can get agreements that might otherwise be difficult. So these are balancing acts. I think going forward, our clear preference would be to have the engagement that preceded the actual agreement being reached, which was very much not just with the committee but with external stakeholders as well, and being able to do that in a more open and transparent way. That would be my preference going forward.
Okay. So would you sort of acknowledge that, I think what you've just set out explains why essentially the sequence happened from an intergovernment mental perspective, but that hasn't necessarily accommodated a parliamentary process that Mum might want.
Yeah, I accept that. I think had we held out to say, no, we're not going to make this agreement unless we can have, I just don't think we would have got the agreement.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, maybe to start off with a few points that have already been raised. I mean, you've said that, you know, we need to have a more fundamental review at some point. Now, let's say theoretically there was a general election in January and a change of government. Could we start the fundamental review in February?
You can be assured that, you know, our key asks around a number of matters will be put to any new government emerging after the general election. Not just on fiscal powers, but really on things like the Internal Market Act, on SUL, on the way governments interact, respect agenda, really trying to, I think, get back to a position of respect. The days of the Memorandum of Understanding, I think, seem a very long way away, and a lot has happened. The Internal Market Act particularly is a real impediment to devolution and an erosion, I think, in so many respects. And it makes the day-to-day interaction with the UK government very difficult. And that's not just a Scottish Government position, I hasten to add. It's a Welsh Government position as well. So I think there is some work that is important around what is the devolved administration's relationship with the UK Government, rather than it being a party political issue. I think there is a more fundamental issue of the relationship between the devolved administrations and the UK Government. The balance of power has shifted, my view, away from the devolved administrations in so many respects. So I think there is an opportunity to reset that and refresh it. And the element of fiscal powers that we've been talking about this morning is one part of that.
Okay, that's helpful. I'm sure that's something we'll return to in the future. And certainly the way this has been done, I mean, the fact that the last time the fiscal framework was set up, everything was on the table as far as I could see. And I think it was John Swinney at the time came back and told us what was happening and we debated it. Whereas this time it was just a limited amount was on the table. So obviously something has changed there. Just going back to the VAT as well, I mean, I think you said that both governments would have to agree either for it to be dropped or for it to go ahead. Is that actually the case? Could Westminster impose it on us?
I don't think they would want to be fair, which, you know, I've got my... To be fair, I think they understand the risks, and I don't see any appetite for a kind of unilateral imposition of VAT assignment in that space. I think in the light of all of the evidence and, you know, organisations from the HMRC and to all, you know, major influential organisations who are all saying the same thing, I can't see any government wanting to impose something that they would do so in the full knowledge of the harm and risk it would cause. So I think what I was getting at earlier on was where we end up, what we end up saying about VAT assignments in terms of, you know, post the review will obviously be discussed at a future joint exchequer committee. I guess the point I was making would be that what I would foresee is some kind of joint position of what we do with VAT assignment going forward.
Okay, thank you. On the kind of bigger picture in all this, I mean, I take your point, and a lot of the experts last week we had were also quite positive about the agreement and the method of the fiscal framework going forward, IPC and so on. However, I have to say I still have some concerns personally, and two of them would be, one, we always seem to be competing with London, and if you know, we have to, our economy has to keep up with the rest of the UK, and on the whole we do keep up with most parts, but every part of Europe, I think, struggles to match London. And is there not a fundamental kind of bias against us? And then we had figures mentioned last week in relation to Barnett and how that's also squeezing our finances. And the suggestion was that in the past we got 129% of a kind of UK, a rest of UK spending. Now we're about 125. It's probably going to fall to 120. It might fall to 115. So when I put all of that together, you know, are we basically being squeezed and squeezed going forward in the longer term? Is that what we've got ourselves tied into?
So I think so in your first point, there are huge issues, I think, relating to population growth for Scotland in relation to elsewhere, in that, you know, are the key levers over migration and some of the key economic levers lie elsewhere. So being able to address that fundamental issue of population growth without levers is very, very difficult. And of course, it then impacts in terms of how the block grant adjustment is applied. So if you take tax take and anticipate, you know, the growth in tax revenues due to tax policy set here in Scotland, and actually the signs are from HMRC data that actually there's a continuing strong performance there, but then that's all put through the block grant adjustment machine on, based on population growth, and what pops out of the other end is what we know to be the case. So it is a challenge. It would require a pretty fundamental change, and that is something that I think is part of a bigger, more fundamental review. The Barnett squeeze, without a doubt, that over time is definitely reducing. I'll bring Matt in or Niall to say more about that if you want. There is a point also if you look at the Crown Estate. So one of the arguments that we made quite strongly about the Crown Estates, for example, was that the investment and focus on the Crown Estates over many years had been particularly focused on London and the South East, without really any investment or focus on, and I'm talking really the pre-devolution period and early, without really any focus on the Crown Estates in Scotland. I think that we've made that a success story in terms of being able to focus on investing in Crown Estates and particularly offshore wind. And the fact that, you know, we ended up, that was part of the negotiation here, I think was a recognition of that success, which post-2016 and the agreement reached then, the success of the Crown Estates since then, I think, has been recognised by the UK government. But, you know, so the point we made was it would not, that underinvestment in the Crown Estates in Scotland compared to London and South East had to be part of the understanding of where we ended up on the Crown Estates position. And I think to some extent we had to compromise a bit, but actually I think we landed that point perhaps, you know, reasonably successfully. So I think there is, I mean, this isn't just an issue for Scotland, it's probably, you know, an issue for other parts of England as well in terms of the relative economic performance to London and the South East. Of course, it has major consequences for us in terms of the funding adjustments that are made as inherently as part of the fiscal framework. So, you know, we were never going to be able to unpick any of that as part of this review, but it is very much an issue of what next, you know, but it would mean some real fundamental look at how the relationship between our budget and UK finance and is really constructed.
Okay. I don't know if Mr. Aylesbury wanted to come in now.
Just on your point on London, I mean, it's absolutely a risk, and it's absolutely something we need to watch. It's also early days, and we are still working with a fiscal framework that is relatively new, and we are still seeing sort of when we are still trying to work out what the long term direction of London and the Scottish economy is going to be over time. The important thing to sort of bear in mind is it's not about the absolute level of wealth in London's South East, it's the extent to which growth in GDP changes in London relative to the rest of the UK, or in England relative to Scotland. And what we do know is it's not clear-cut. So since 2007, we've seen GDP per person grow by about 10% in Scotland relative to about 6% in the UK. So it does vary, and it's not completely clear. It's something I think we will only have a clearer view when we've got lots more data on this, but it is absolutely right to say this is a risk and something we should note.
Okay, well, I think I'm assured that it's on the table, at least in the longer term, we'll be looking at it. I think just a couple of other specific questions, if I may. The £600 million resource borrowing, we've been told by some that that might not be enough because the forecast was, thankfully, didn't happen, but the adjustment might have been greater than that?
Well, again, it was a negotiation and we would have wanted that to go further than £600 million. But essentially, that, again, was a landing space and a compromise. And we got to where we got to, and we had to make a judgment of whether to settle on £600 million. And in the light of my concerns about the negative tax reconciliation, you can see why progress was progress in relation to that. But yes, we would have wanted that to go further if we could have negotiated that.
Okay, and
so we did look at what impact the borrowing powers would have on the likelihood of not being able to meet an income tax reconciliation. Before with the £300 million limit, we assessed that there was a 14% to 27% risk that a negative reconciliation would breach those powers. That is now reduced to a 2% to 13% risk. So there is still some risk in there. There is still the possibility that they do not cover an income tax or any tax reconciliation, but they are significantly improved. It is worth saying that is within the current devolution settlement, and if we were to take on, say, that assignment, those borrowing limits would not be enough to address that sort of risk.
No intention of doing clearly, but the point as well about the negative tax reconciliation, the big negative tax reconciliation that we thought we were facing next year, which is reduced, thankfully, was of course very much related to the forecasting during the pandemic. So the figures that Matthew's set out around the percentage risk, I think, puts it into a space of it would not be anticipated that you would have a negative tax reconciliation of that magnitude very often. And you know, it was very much related to that set of circumstances at the time.
Now, I accept that, although the 13% at the higher end of your list, I mean, that's every once 7 or 8 years, so it's still could happen. And my final point then was, there's no, I think the idea of a Scottish specific shock and provisions for that has now been dropped. Can you just say anything about why that is?
Oh, well, I think because of the changes to resource borrowing, being able to borrow up to £600 million, I think was regarded as being able to kind of bake in some of that to the normal state of affairs in terms of the fiscal framework. But Matt, I don't know.
Yeah, I might be bringing Neil on as well, but I think it's absolutely true that sort of a new powers effectively overwrite the existing settlement. There's the question of should Scotland have particular powers during an economic shock. What we did find in our previous experience was the previous powers didn't really work particularly well. And the reason was because of the timing and the fact that you weren't able to time particular borrowing powers to the year that the shock actually happened.
And I think it feeds back into the earlier discussion that actually what we need is a look at the fiscal powers more generally, that even with further tweaks of levels of resource borrowing, that doesn't change some of the fundamental weaknesses of being able to respond to an economic shock, whether it's COVID pandemic or any other. It is very limited levers, and even with tweaks to some of the levels, it wouldn't suffice.
Yeah. Yeah. Just one point: the Scotland-specific economic shock powers on resource borrowing and reserve are now effectively in the revised fiscal framework on a BAU basis. So there's no need for it in that context anyway.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Jamie, to be followed by Audrey.
Thanks very much. A number of the points obviously have been covered today, but I just wanted to go back to VAT assignment. And just to be very clear, notwithstanding obviously the concerns raised during the round table and by experts and the concerns raised today by members of this committee, is it still the Scottish Government's ambition that VAT assignment does go ahead?
So our ambition would be for VAT, but with the levers and policy levers to be able to manage that. So the problem with VAT assignment is you are assigned the revenues, but you have none of the levers in terms of being able to deal with risk. So you get the risk, but none of the benefit. So clearly, if VAT was devolved with all of the controls over VAT, then that's a very different proposition, but that's not what was on the table. So the problem with assignments is essentially that you get all of the risk and none of the benefit of being able to actually use it as a tax lever to raise revenue. So we would not think I've explained earlier on that the evidence now is so compelling that the discussion, ongoing discussion with the UK government needs, I think, both governments to reach a position on what we do with VAT assignments going forward, but we will continue to want the devolution of VAT in full with the policy levers attached to be able to manage.
You've made clear during the discussions you've had with the Scottish Government that you've had, with the UK Government, you've had to work within the parameters of negotiations, that the UK Government's had a clear position and that you've worked within those parameters. So, taking that principle forward and those negotiations that you're having, how can you overcome some of the concerns that have been raised and perhaps the concerns that you have if you're still operating within those parameters?
In relation to VAT assignment? Well, I think that's what we need to resolve with the UK government around, there are choices of do we continue to try and find a way to mitigate the risk. I think a lot of work has been done on that, and I think the conclusion is that's very difficult. Or do we agree that it's just not feasible to be done as an assignment without the policy levers? There could be agreement, highly unlikely, that we would get the devolution of VAT with those policy levers. And the third option is that we agree that it is not feasible to go forward with it on the basis of all of the risk that is agreed, and that in the light of the evidence since 2016, which wouldn't have been understood at the time in the way it is now, that there's a decision that it's the risk is too great. That decision hasn't been made yet, so I think I would want to leave the space at the Joint Exchequer Committee to come to some conclusions over that. It'll be a joint conclusion.
Yeah, I'll come to that in a second. I was just going to ask, the methodology developed by the Scottish Government and the Treasury and HMRC is obviously the model that's been used. It's been based, I think, on the VAT total theoretical liability model. Is that model in itself part of the discussions?
I think yes, but I think the question is could any model remove the risk of having the assignments but no levers to be able to manage the risk? And I think the point was made earlier on by someone that in the current fiscal climate, that risk would be at its optimum had we gone forward, and the impact on the Scottish budget would have been profound. Now, no one so far has been able to find a model that would de-risk that. If one exists, it's not yet been found. So, theoretically, but if, you know, in the light of that so far, with all of the wise heads that have been looking at this, have not managed to find a way. So I come back to the point, there needs to be a joint conclusion of, so what do we do next? And
taking on the basis of that need for a joint conclusion and working with the Joint Exchequer Committee, I suppose, what do you see as the timescales around this? Because obviously this can't be a kind of open-ended, elongated process. There must be timescales that you and colleagues are working to.
Yeah, so there is a further meeting of officials in the new year to look at where we have got to. I mentioned earlier on that the evidence that's been heard by this committee will be an important part of that. And then the outcome of those discussions will be considered at a future meeting of the Joint Exchequer Committee. It may well be that officials put the best outcome, I think, would be that officials working together with Treasury officials put some joint recommendations to us. That would be the best space, and then a decision is made. And as I said earlier, happy to keep the committee updated.
Do you mean recommendations in terms of how obstacles can be overcome, or recommendations on, look, you know, this isn't going to be workable from both sides, let's park this, essentially?
So that would be what we would be looking for, what the recommendations would be to ministers in terms of, these are the conclusions that officials have come to in terms of what the art of the possible is. So we're not at that stage yet. We need to let that process go through. And as I say, we require, I guess what I was saying was that would be the optimum, that recommendations are made to ministers that we can jointly agree. Okay.
Thank you. Audrey.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. I've been listening to the information shared this morning with great interest, and the Cabinet Secretary will know that I'm Convener of the Justice Committee, Criminal Justice Committee, and we've recently been undertaking our pre-budget scrutiny process. And I think it's safe to say that the evidence that we've heard during that process has reflected the significant challenges that we're all familiar with, but particularly in and around the capital budget. And I would say that that's particularly difficult for the prison service and the fire service. And I think in some of the evidence we've heard, what has been certainly indicated is that sort of yearly increases in budget are just no longer meeting the needs of parts of the sector, and that obviously brings it with it risk. And in fact, last week we had the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs in giving evidence, and she spoke about, and I quote, I think it was that there was a need, where possible, to have a longer term spend to save vision. So without hijacking the Finance Committee into a mini Criminal Justice Committee, just in general terms, given the context of the Fiscal Framework Review, is there any scope to start thinking about more of a spend-to-save approach? I think particularly given Cabinet Secretary, you spoke about financial management arrangements were more sustainable on the back of the review. However, the capital budget is still challenging and not inflation-proofed.
So So there's a few issues in there. So the first one is we can't escape the fact that capital budgets, unless something changes tomorrow, will decline, and therefore the purchasing power of what can be developed, built, with that reducing capital availability is constrained, and therefore we will need to prioritise, and I'll set our proposition out in the budget. We are keen and recognise very much that modernising and improving the prison estate to ensure it's fit for purpose is a priority. And we know the pressures on the prison estate at the moment are challenging, to say the least, so we recognise that. You touched on spend to save, and I guess that is part of the reform agenda that I'm taking forward on behalf of the whole of government, and that is to look at ways of doing things differently, whether it's on resource or capital. So one of the issues we're looking at the moment is the public sector estate in its widest sense, and looking at what we do where and why. So one of the challenges of future investment in the net zero space is that a requirement to bring public buildings up to scratch in terms of net zero emissions, but there'll be some buildings that just don't make sense to do that, given the cost, but that will require us to think about co-location and where things are done, taking into account patterns of home working, office working, having changed since COVID. So all of that is being looked at in the work on the estate strategy. And then just looking more widely at the reform of public bodies and fiscal sustainability, and one of the issues is the balance of workforce and where that sits, and the affordability in terms of the size of the workforce and what the workforce does going forward. So all of that needs to be taken forward carefully, and we need to make sure that what we end up with, and this is going to take time, it's not going to happen in the short term, is a sustainable set of public services that are able to continue to provide high quality service, but they may look and feel a bit different than they do at the moment. And the prison estate and the justice system is one part of that.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. And certainly, again, in our evidence sessions, the opportunities in and around reform were covered. And as you say, particularly in the context of the Scottish prison estate, where a big part of the capital budget is supporting that reform process in terms of modernising the estate. And also, I suppose that would apply to Police Scotland, where they have their estate strategy and looking at trying to modernise and upgrade their estate as well. So I suppose that just really brings me on to my next question. It maybe comes and picks
Audrey,
up on...
it's about the fiscal framework. You kind of, I know you've only had 1 hour's notice of the meeting, but you're kind of moving a wee bit away from the subject matter that we're discussing and deliberating over today.
Thanks. What I was going to ask was, in the context of the new fiscal framework, then, as part of the parliamentary budget scrutiny, then, I suppose my question is how the new framework should inform and perhaps change the way that committees approach their budget scrutiny going forward.
So I think probably for most committees of the parliament, I think it's fair to say that the fiscal framework will probably be something that is over in this committee's territory just because of its complexity. Now, I guess there'll be a kind of high-level understanding of there's some changes that are in the main beneficial, but it probably isn't going to feature as a kind of main line of inquiry by committees that are looking at, for example, the capital investment in the prison estate or in transport or anything else. I guess, though, you know, where it matters is around, you know, the resource borrowing, the capital borrowing, the reserve drawdown limits that, taken together, you know, have some limited impact on the margins rather than, you know, a game changer for the capital outlook of the of Scottish public finances going forward. So I suspect it will be on the margins rather than at the centre.
Thank you. Okay, that's concluded questions from the committee other than myself. I still have one or two just to wind up. Surprise, surprise. And it's just basically, given that VAT assignment is effectively a dead duck after 8 years of deliberations, I'm just wondering if we are, as a Scottish Government, to pursue, for example, VAT devolution, or indeed decides to look at how we can press for devolution of other areas. Of course, it takes two to tango, and the UK Government might not be keen, but say, for example, devolution of alcohol and tobacco duties, given a disproportionate income that would generate, given an overconsumption of both those substances. I'm just wondering, where would the internal market bill come into play there, given the fact you did touch on it in an earlier response? Or indeed, if you were not, and I should say, what would your priorities be other than VAT assignment? Would it be national insurance, corporation tax, or some of the other taxes I've mentioned?
Yeah, so clearly we have, you know, set out over the years many of our asks around fiscal powers, the borrowing power, the prudential borrowing that, you know, you mentioned at the start of the session around the disconnect of local authorities in many respects having a more straightforward borrowing capacity than the Scottish Government. So there's some fundamental asks. Now, you add into that the other financial levers that we've asked for, you know, VAT devolution would be one. Then, you know, again, it's a much more expansive ask, requiring a different political environment and willingness to look beyond the confines of what we've been looking at. I don't know whether that will be there or not, but we'll continue, I think, to put forward the proposition that Scotland needs that basket of fiscal powers to be able to deliver on the ambitions on both capital and resource within a sustainable way, an affordable way, but one that recognises that the economic shocks that we've been dealing with and are still dealing with in the midst of a cost of living crisis, that the levers we have are very limited. So I think it's a good point at which to say, look, looking back, you know, we need to have a more fundamental review of the powers that we have. You make the point, it takes two to tango, it absolutely does. And I think that is where we would have to find a landing space that is acceptable to both governments. The Internal Market Act, you know, the use of the Internal Market Act isn't covered by the fiscal framework, and it therefore wasn't part of the negotiations. But it is a major issue of being able to, you know, bypass you know, transparency in how public money is allocated in Scotland in areas for which this Parliament is responsible really cuts to the heart of devolution. And I think our ask, and it will be an ask of the Welsh Government, I am sure, as well, is for that to be recognised, and that really that's, I guess, a reset is required.
That was a fiscal framework was negotiated in 2016. The Internal Market Bill was imposed in 2020. So it's about whether or not it will have an impact as we go forward if other areas are to be devolved. And I think that's an area we would certainly seek clarity on, assuming, I mean, John Mason talked about a new government. So it's whether or not Sir Ed Davey, his new administration, would be keen, actually, you know, on bringing all these having a better discussion with the Scottish Government.
To test that.
Yes, indeed. So I think we're in a kind of position almost of flux in a way. So although there's been a settlement and you know, there's been agreement that this will only come in once every 5-year term, I mean, one thing that John did point out was the fact that that 5-year term could be upon us relatively soon, a year, 18 months at the most, I would think. So that's why I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government is looking at these issues now and is looking for the next stage in terms of fiscal framework, and whether or not the Scottish Government is looking at other devolved administrations around the world. For example, I mean, that a previous committee which I served on visited the Basque country, and only about 6.3%, 6.29%, I think, actually, of their revenue is actually handed back to the Spanish government. The rest is all devolved. I mean, they've got pensions, social security. It's only really the monarchy, civil guard, and defence that's actually reserved. I feel like everything else is dealt with locally. So there are other models to look at. I'm just wondering what modus vivendi you think we might be able to reach in future, and whether you're having contact with other potential political parties who could form a future UK government with regard to that.
So we are obviously keen to take advantage of any new thinking to be able to get into a different space. We know that those things happen on two levels. One is government to government. So we are preparing obviously some of the groundwork. Some of that will be Scottish government, some of it will be shared devolution space with the Welsh government around key asks and getting on the front foot with what the proposition would be. Now, clearly, some of our priorities will be a bit different from the Welsh government's priorities, but I think there are some shared aims of resetting respect agenda, issues of to do with SEWL, IMA, and so on. Welsh government are clearly in a different space in terms of fiscal powers, but they want enhanced fiscal powers and they want enhanced social security powers. So the devolved nations are very much pushing in a direction of we want to see further power and responsibility devolved and levers devolved. The party space is obviously a bit more tricky, and communication kind of happens through personal connections and more in the kind of private space, I guess you could say. So, whenever there is an election and there's potential for, a new government to come in, then, there is an opportunity there to be seized upon. However, you made the point, I come back to your point about it takes two to tango, and that would require then new thinking and thinking differently. The opportunities for government and and the civil service to get in the room to talk about doing things differently and a different approach is really led by the political willingness and the political signal to avoid a situation where business just continues as usual, whether that's the Scotland office or whether it's the Treasury or any other UK department in the way it views the Scottish Government. So political steer and political appetite is going to be really important there. But there is an opportunity, without a doubt, and from the Scottish Government's point of view, we are really keen to seize that opportunity because otherwise we don't get the maximum benefit of doing things in a way that are for the benefit of Scotland's public services and the people of Scotland.
Yeah, okay, thanks. I could push more on that because it's quite interesting, the settled status of the Basque country in terms of it, regardless of which government is in power in Madrid, and yet that's not kind of the situation we have here. But
That requires a whole new reset and a whole new, the sky's the limit in terms of could you do things completely differently? Of course, but you'd have to get the the other side of the negotiation on the same page with some of that, and that's obviously what we don't know what the appetite would be.
Okay, absolutely. Just to finish up, do you have any further points you want to make to committee? Anything you feel that we've maybe omitted, or any points you wish to make in view of the kind of discussion that we've had over the last hour and a half or so?
I don't think so. I think we've covered the main points. I just really want to thank the committee for the evidence sessions and the very clear steer you're giving us on VAT assignment. I think that's very helpful. And going forward, I will do my best to keep the committee as informed as I can.
Thank you very much, and thank you obviously to Matthew and Niall for their contributions. Also, that concludes the evidence we've planned on the fiscal framework review and report and VAT assignment. We'll consider next steps in private at our next meeting. So as that also concludes the public part of today's meeting, the next item of our agenda will be discussed in private. We therefore have a 5-minute break to enable the Cabinet Secretary officials and official report to leave. Thank you.